Welcome to the Nobody Guide to Life, where we provide tips and tools for personal growth, personal development, and your spiritual journey that you can use right now in your everyday life. I'm J.A. Plosker. Thank you for joining us. Find out more at nobodysview.com or thenobodybible.com, or you can check us out at Twitter and Facebook at Nobody's View. If you like what you hear, we'd welcome a subscription or a review. We'd appreciate it. Have you ever done that thing where you just sit quietly and try to bring up the most obscure memories from your past? No? Okay, so it's just me? All right, so anyway, I do that sometimes, and it's really interesting what comes bubbling up to the surface. I can remember finding a really cool bottle cap on a dusty road when I was around 9. It completed some, I don't know, some weird collection I was putting together of bottle caps from different flavored sodas. I was really excited. Then there was the time that a babysitter took me to skip stones in one of the Great Lakes. I don't remember which one. I think I was 4. I can remember how frustrating it was getting the wrist motion just right. I can still remember that feeling of frustration of not being able to get it right. Just the splashes and the splashes, and I wasted a lot of good rocks. So it took me a while, but I used that rock skipping skill a lot through the years. So I think more than I used algebra, at least. So, you know, some nice things come up, ice cream cones and sights from road trips. And then there are the not so nice things that come up. So the times I've been really sick or rejections of various types and more rejections of various types. So at one time while doing this, I got a little more in depth and I decided to take this whole memory thing a step further. So I took that walk through the corridors of my mind and was looking in the nooks and crannies for the answers to this question. How many times has something been as bad as I thought it would be? Now that's an interesting question, right? Or at least I thought it was an interesting question. So I tried it. So there it was, a new challenge. So no more bottle caps, stone skipping, and ice cream. I closed my eyes and I took a walk in my head and tried to come up with a situation from the not-so-nice pile that turned out as bad as I thought it would. So what were the results of this highly informal study? Well, it was this. Not a lot. I was actually really, really hard-pressed to come up with a situation I worried about that actually turned out as badly as I thought. Now I'm certainly not saying to you, I mean, I haven't been through some wild stuff. I'm not saying I haven't been disappointed in my life. I'm not saying things have always gone the way I expected or left me feeling not so good. I'm just saying that my catastrophic thinking, often it didn't pan out as catastrophic as I thought it would. So what's the proof of that? Well, I'm still here. I'm still breathing. You know, I remember to help calm my nerves before my first college lecture when I was back teaching university classes, my dad told me this. He said, hey, no matter how bad of a lecturer you are, they can't kill you. Now, I mean, they could have, but they didn't. And, you know, it went great. And he was right. And there were problems and issues that came up along the way, but it was never as bad as I thought it would be. And I'm still standing. And that's the point. And if you're listening to today's show, you're still standing too. Congratulate yourself on that. Okay, so what was the purpose of that whole exercise? What does it mean? Well, you know what it means. You know, I don't have to tell you, many times when we're faced with a fear, a new experience, or a miserable situation, we go off the deep end in our mind and we let ourselves imagine all sorts of horrific outcomes, all kinds of terrible situations. We catastrophize and convince ourselves of the worst, even when the worst isn't happening. Now, that isn't a term I made up, by the way, catastrophizing. That isn't some brilliant idea I came up with on this podcast just for you today. It actually has a solid place out there in the world. It has a meaning apart from people like me who sometimes enjoy making up words. So if you look up that word, catastrophize, if you look it up on Merriam-Webster online, the first stop for so many of us, you'll see this. To imagine the worst possible outcome of an action or event, to think about a situation or event as being a catastrophe or having a potentially catastrophic outcome. That's the feel-good definition of the year, right? So sit with that for a while and see how you feel after a few minutes. And if you want to get a little more complex about it, you can look in the American Psychological Association dictionary and you'll find this entry on catastrophizing. To exaggerate the negative consequences of events or decisions, people are said to be catastrophizing when they think that the worst possible outcome will occur from a particular action or in a particular situation, or when they feel as if they are in the midst of a catastrophe in situations that may be serious and upsetting, but are not necessarily disastrous. The tendency to catastrophize can unnecessarily increase levels of anxiety and lead to maladaptive behavior. So did you hear that last line there? I'll read it again. The tendency to catastrophize can unnecessarily increase levels of anxiety and lead to maladaptive behavior. So you see that our thoughts, as you no doubt know, can increase anxiety in our physical body, increase those feelings. And again, you know that, but you still do it. I still do it. We all still do it. Everyone you know still does it. The pull towards catastrophizing is magnetic for some reason. We're drawn to it like that old saying, like a moth to a flame. We know nothing good is going to come from it, but yet we do it anyway. We do it to ourselves. So why? I mean, do we do it to prepare ourselves? I mean, maybe we're trying to steel ourselves against the oncoming onslaught of whatever it is that we're imagining. Probably. That's probably part of why we do it. I'm sure that kind of catastrophic thinking has roots in the days when we needed to protect ourselves from danger that was always imminent. But nowadays, well, we still catastrophize even when we may not need to. Maybe we want to ask someone out and we're afraid of rejection. That's one that's common to almost all of us. That's a big one. Or maybe we believe if we don't have enough pastry on hand for Sunday brunch, our friends will talk about it for ages to come and people will think we're irresponsible and horrible. They'll reject our invitations and never want to talk to us again. Just a side note on that one. Trust me, if your friends are that petty, losing them wouldn't be a catastrophe. But whatever. The point is this. We all do this. Now, that APA dictionary definition, that one I just read you, it goes on to tell us something else. It says that the verb catastrophizing, as well as its synonym awfulize, that's a great word, was coined by Albert Ellis. So thank you for that, Albert Ellis. Hopefully he came up with some happy words like joyification or celebration or something to offset the negative energy of catastrophize and awfulize, but he probably didn't. So who was this Albert Ellis guy? Well, he was the pioneer of a therapy called Rational Emotive Behavioral Therapy, or REBT, a form of popular kind of therapy called cognitive behavioral therapy. So with REBT, clients are taught, and I'm going to quote here, they're taught to identify, challenge, and replace their self-defeating beliefs with healthier ones that promote emotional well-being and goal achievement. So that sounds pretty good. So what does that mean? Well, according to REBT, it's thinking about events that leads to emotional and behavioral upset. So that sounds about right, right? So clients are taught to stay in the present and challenge unhealthy thoughts that arise. So people are forced to confront the question, what is it that I believe day to day that causes me to get upset? You know, it's really present focused, is very mindful. So that's something we're used to on this show. It's not things necessarily that get us down, events. It's our perception of things, our perception of events. I guess in a sense, we defeat ourselves with thoughts when we blame ourselves and shame ourselves and tell ourselves we're not good enough. We tell ourselves all the things we should and must be, things we probably can't always control. So think of it this way. Something in life, let's just say, comes along and disappoints you. But it's not necessarily going to destroy you. And I think that's really a mantra we can all take with us. Something in life may disappoint us, but it's not necessarily going to destroy us. So I won't go too much more into REBT than that. In our show notes at nobodysview.com, you can follow a link to more on Ellis and what he taught, and maybe some words that he made up to make us feel good. But there's that language that so many of you probably know, the present, the now, challenging catastrophic thinking by realizing that you're here in the present moment. Now, I don't want to give you the idea on this show that being mindful is a cure-all for everything. It's not. But what it can help you do is enforce a moment of pause, enforce a stop, enforce a gap. When an event occurs and our thoughts about it start to spiral out of control, we can at least try to notice the spiral. Look, you may still tumble down to the bottom of the spiral, but know you're tumbling. Notice it. And look, I'm not suggesting that the end to anxiety lies in a few moments of paying attention, okay? That's for most of us, that's not reality. What I'm suggesting is that we've created habits of thinking about life and situations that cause us to catastrophize, that cause us to think the worst of people and of situations, even when that thinking is irrational. Those patterns of thought create in us disturbing emotions almost as habitual as the thinking that got us there. And we probably behave based on those emotions out of habit. So in college, maybe it looked like this. You want to ask a person on a date. That triggers a memory, maybe one you're not even conscious of being rejected previously in your life, maybe in middle school or high school when you ask someone there out on a date. That rejection likely triggered a belief in you that you were unattractive or unworthy of love and companionship, or that people don't like you, whatever it is. There's a million different thoughts we could have. So now, as you get ready in college to make new friends or ask more people on dates, you're brought to that place of unworthiness, of anxiety and depression. So rejection, or just the prospect of rejection by anyone, sends you into a spiral of avoidance, of anxiety, of feelings of inadequacy, of shame, and on it goes. But what if you simply learn to notice those feelings? Now, I'm not saying you rush up to every person you meet and ask them out or to be their friend. I'm just saying, what if when you formed the idea of asking for a date, or even just the idea that you want to talk to someone at a party, and that rejection, shame, anxiety spiral begins, what if you just noticed it? Don't let it hide in the corridors of your mind that we were talking about at the start of the episode. Instead, feel it and take stock of it. Remember, not everyone likes everyone else. And no matter how many times you've been in a position of rejection or dreading something, you've lived to see another day. What if you did that over and over again? What if you challenge those insidious thoughts? The rejection hurt, but it didn't kill you. And what's the worst that happens now? Another rejection? Someone doesn't want to be your friend? Well, look, if we're lucky, we get 70 to 90 good years. And sometimes it helps to think of it this way. One no in one moment of those years isn't going to stop the course of the universe. Look, if it did, if one no had the power to stop the course of all time in the universe, then all life as we know it and life we don't know about would have ceased to exist probably sometime around my sophomore year of high school, around the time of the winter dance. Look, take today's episode for what it's worth. By now, you know me well enough to know I'm not lecturing you. I know the world is a tough place. I know life can get hard. I know we get disappointed, but we still have to live for our kids, for our pets, for our friends, and for ourselves. So think about your thoughts and how they lead you to your emotions and behaviors, even in ways you might not be aware of, even in automatic ways. Take small steps today to create new ways of thinking that better match reality, that can better match the rational thinking of the moment. Affirm the idea that no matter what happens, you're still here. So that brings us to the end of this episode of the Nobody Guide to Life. I'd be very interested to know what you're up to out there. If you like, you can join our Simple Spirituality group on Facebook and put something into the conversation, get some feedback. And remember, you can always find out more about what we're doing at nobodysview.com or thenobodybible.com. Or you can reach out to us on Twitter and Facebook at Nobody's View. If you like what you hear on this podcast, please consider a review or a subscription. We'd really appreciate it. Keep practicing and have a good week.